Thank you all so much for being here, and thanks so much to the Fitzwilliam team, Helen and Vicky and everybody, for organizing this and giving us a last chance to say goodbye to this exhibition. A show like this is always the work of many years, so it's been really great to have a chance to see it again without the crowds of the opening night. And I want to thank the many artists who are here, some of our lenders. I want to call out John Driscoll, without whom we couldn't have done the show in New Haven. Thank you all for the support of this project. So I wanted to tell you a little bit about the background of the exhibition at the Yale Center for British Art, which is where the show originated, and also talk a little bit about the curatorial strategy and rationale behind the exhibition. So before it came here to this encyclopedic museum, which houses a very significant global collection of ceramics and other arts. The exhibition opened here at Yale. This is the Yale Center for British Art, a modernist building designed by Louis Kahn, a very iconic piece of architecture. And the collection housed inside this building does not include ceramics of any kind or decorative arts at all. And actually, for that matter, very few or relatively few works of sculpture. The collection is best known for its landscape and portraiture paintings, dating in particular to the long 18th century. We have works beyond that, but that is kind of the heart of the collection. The collection was established by the Anglophile philanthropist Paul Mellon, the namesake of the Paul Mellon Center, which supported this event. And the collection reflects an earlier conception of great British art as essentially being about great British painting. So we necessarily reflect that legacy on a daily basis in our permanent collection installation, and you can see our library court here, and in other parts of the museum. And so we constantly find ourselves pushing against these narratives and trying to open them up and to tell a more complete story of British art in its rich breadth and materialities. And while we're somewhat limited in how we can do that through the collections, our exhibitions and our publications are a critical way in which we can contribute meaningfully to this expansion of beyond the collection. To show you an example of one other instance in which we highlighted ceramic arts kind of front and center at Yale. We showed this work, an earthenware majolica elephant by Minton from the late 19th century, as part of an exhibition, Sculpture Victorious, Art in an Age of Invention, which then traveled to the Tate. And as I was listening to Tanya earlier, who mentioned the inclusion of ceramics in the Royal Academy exhibition, Modern British Sculpture, well, this show, when it traveled to the Tate, the elephant became a focus maybe of a similar kind of anxiety amongst the critics who really didn't feel that a work of ceramic like this was confluent with or sympathetic to so-called fine art sculpture. And so a ceramic object in this instance made a very powerful intervention into an expected fine art narrative. Things of Beauty Growing, and I'm showing you installation views. I hope you can see them a little bit in this bright light. This is how it was installed at Yale. This was our first sustained scholarly investigation of modern pottery as a subject in its own right. And I think it helped us expand and complicate in a helpful way the words art and British, which are the key words in the title of our museum, the Yale Center for British Art. And as our exhibition title says, this is a show about British studio pottery, but in the context of our galleries, we really wanted to suggest from the outset, this is how Claire's vases looked at Yale, and you'll have just seen them through here, very different. We wanted to show as you walked into the building and through this installation called Made in China, that this phrase, British studio pottery, in fact contains a series of questions. And of course it was our hope that this exhibition would open questions for our audiences and throw open to debate some of the assumptions that we might bring to ideas of what British art is. So as a collection of British art in North America, we always strive to represent a broader global view of British art and culture. And the ceramics exhibition, I think, was an important means for us to continue to make that message part of what we do. The show sets out British studio pottery as something inherently international, going in multiple directions and touching the whole world through the movement of people, objects, and materials. And as the exhibition at Yale began with Made in China, confronting that loaded phrase with a celebration of centuries-old Chinese traditions, it ended with a work called Virtues of Unity, which you'll have just seen upstairs, by Halima Cassell, an open-ended, perhaps never-to-be-completed series of vessels made from clays collected by the artists from all corners of the globe, and we'll hear Halima speak later. So I just want to show you some images of how we install the exhibition, and we have amazing daylight in our galleries, and this was really a rare opportunity to have all of our windows open and really flood the galleries with natural light, because these objects are not light sensitive. So we made this exhibition, as I'm sure you've surmised after being upstairs, specifically about the vessel. So it's about the pot that resides in the word pottery. And we wanted to explore the persistence of the major forms and typologies of the vessel, the jar, the vase, the bowl, the charger, the set, etc. So the exhibition is based on quite a simple rationale, but an effective one for taking a new approach to material that may, in some respects, be familiar, and thereby hopefully raise some new questions. For us in New Haven, it was important not to weigh down our show with a genealogy of the potters. A lot of the names in the show, which may be household names over here, were not familiar to our audiences. And so we wanted to invite our viewers to think about the pots first and foremost. And so for us, maybe less so than at the Fitzwilliam, this was also an opportunity to think about how we define art practices and how we categorize objects, the Yale Center being exclusively about so-called fine art. So the exhibition makes a clear distinction. I'm kind of coming back a little bit to some of the issues, points raised in Tanya's talk. It's a show about pottery, and it's not about other kinds of ceramic sculpture, and of course there is a vibrant practice of ceramic sculpture out there, but we didn't include that kind of work by focusing specifically on the pot. At the same time, some of the pots are very sculptural, and so Tanya kind of pointed to that conundrum, and that it does have ramifications for how that work is evaluated and thought about. Commonly, the distinction between sculpture and pottery, or decorative arts more broadly, rests on ideas about art versus function or utility. And ceramics and pottery are almost inherently or automatically associated with function, whereas sculpture is not. But walking through this show, beginning with Made in China, of course, and then ending with Halima's perforated bowls, the great majority of the works in this show, as I think you'll have noticed upstairs, are not and never were functional in the way that the word might imply. So we wanted to think about function as operating at the level of the metaphorical, the ceremonial, and the symbolic, and maybe more than that, also to think of function in a similar way to iconography or subject matter, the kinds of words we apply to painting and sculpture. So function as a formal, visual, embodied kind of iconography. And in this exhibition, as I hope you felt as you walked through the show upstairs, the typologies of the vessel are, in a sense, the subject matter. So we began our show at Yale, as it does here, with the iconic form of the moon jar to help us allude to some of our major themes from the outset, in particular the connection between deep historic traditions, and Simon will talk a little more about the Korean moon jar, and modern practice, and the persistent return and reformulation and reinvention of familiar forms over time. So we created a loose chronology with each type of form, each type of vessel, bringing its own patina of time, beginning with the bowl, the vase, and the charger. We also included, as you saw upstairs, a section on the service or the set. You can see the Duckworth set in the background and the Rhee in the foreground. And we wanted to remind our viewers that potters did produce functional tableware, but by making that reminder, also a contrast, highlighting that so much else on view in the exhibition does not operate on the level of utility. Looking at the vessel, it's the word we used for the sort of 70s, 80s, and later to mark a change of pace and an explicit rejection of even the idea of functionality and an open embrace of sculpture, as well as painting. And yet, nevertheless, all of the vessels in this section also, all of the works in this section nevertheless continue to take the vessel and the idea of the container as a reference point. So all of these objects are still containers, and they refer back to that originary purpose of ceramics, even in their rejection of it. And then that pace changes again, and you can see Jeff Lee's wonderful pots in the foreground here. The pace changes with a re-emphasis on the simple and self-contained and, I would say, concentrated forms of the individual pots. And each of these works, I think, operates both at the level of the singular object and the series of objects. And that's how we showed them, like still lifes. And then from these tiny, careful, small pots, we ended the exhibition, as the Fitzwilliam did upstairs, with a section that we called Monument. And at Yale, our gallery spaces open up into these double-sized spaces with floor-to-ceiling windows. And we showed large-scale vessels by Julian Stair, Liz Aliff, Lawson Oyakhan, and also Ruth Duckworth and Martin Cajet Smith, who I think you see here. And so both works that are literally monumental, or overtowering, and works that are monumental or oversized for what is expected of their form. But I think all of them, in a sense, indicate a desire to take the vessel beyond the domestic and into the realm of monumental sculpture. And so we ended the show with this amazing piece, Virtues of Unity, The Clays of the World. And behind it, we showed the worlds of the potter. And I know not all of our potters who participated in this project welcomed being photographed, but we were really thrilled that Ben Boswell, who's been photographing potters for over 30 years, undertook a campaign of photography. And we were able to end our exhibition with this photo mural, so that after walking through a history of the pot, our viewers came back to the makers themselves. And I think I'm so thrilled that some of our makers are here and, you know, were involved in our installation in New Haven, and I know the Fitzwilliam worked with some of the potters here as well, and I'm really thankful to them for their loans and for entrusting us to do this exhibition with their work. I'm going to now hand over to Simon to talk about the moon jar. Thank you.